Chris. I might have a job for you, and I need a quote. I'm afraid it's a bit complicated.
No need to ask, he's a smooth operator.
I'm booked out, actually. Sorry not to be of help. Fuck!
Especially when starting out, the process of quoting can be stressful for any freelancer. How do you formulate your initial rates? And how do you consistently quote for a whole multitude of different projects which might be operating at different scales? Especially when a client might not even know all of the answers to your questions. So, I wanted to take this opportunity to first recap a number of useful resources, and then demonstrate how I break down the quoting process for two of the biggest areas to my business, which are the corporate projects and the commercial projects. Now, resources like the Gravy for the Bread and GVAA rate cards can be incredibly useful, but they can also be initially quite overwhelming, both to us as freelancers and also to our clients. One of my first videos laid out pricing guidelines from a client's perspective, and I also made reference there to the Gravy for the Brain video on rights usage more generally, which is a really useful resource and touch point. I've also previously discussed things like revision fees, and they're something that should be inbuilt to your terms and conditions. The main thing with something like revision fees is that you're very clear about what your process is, that you have terms and conditions, and that you link these to clients before they accept a quote. Actually, asking a client to sign a contract can sometimes provide too much additional friction, so you might not want to actually insist on that, but still being able to link to something in advance, I think, is absolutely essential if you then subsequently have to go down the road of discussing what revision fees may be applicable. And when in doubt, always get on the phone first, because especially when discussing the subjective nature of revision fees, it's always best to get on the phone and discuss person to person, and I would always recommend this rather than going backwards and forwards via email, where figures quoted can seem somewhat immutable. At the end of the day, your client might not be your end client, so you need to be able to offer a good level of customer service and understanding. That should be taken as a given. So strap yourself in and let's get down to it, because for the vast majority of corporate and commercial work, what you need to really understand is your basic studio fee and three different types of usage. So getting straight into the quoting, the first thing that we need to establish is our basic studio fee, or BSF. And this is essentially what you can record and edit within 1 hour of your time. So of course, what you need to first establish is what can you do with an hour of your time in a studio. An hour long recording, which could be up to about, say, 8,000 words, can take probably another 2 to 3 hours to actually edit into a final audio. Which is why for most long form projects, such as e-learning, we negotiate on a per word or per minute, or at most a per finished hour rate instead. But for the vast majority of corporate and commercial work, which we're discussing here, you'll be looking at spots that last from anywhere between 15 to 20 seconds to 5 to 10 minutes on average. So all of which is achievable within 1 hour, or one BSF fee. Now, a BSF can vary hugely, generally anywhere from £150 all the way up to £500 and £600 for some of the big hitters. Mine sits at £250 as of March 2022, but I started 4 or 5 years ago at the £150 mark and then have gradually been working my way up. Now, rather than just plucking a figure between those two parameters out of thin air, it's good to actually be mindful of what your BSF actually consists. It's the hiring of your studio and equipment, it's your audio engineering skills, it's your capacity to offer live direction for fine tuning of a performance, it's your experience and training as a voiceover artist, it's your experience and training on other skills such as copywriting, check out this video about voiceover USPs for more on that, and it also incorporates your capacity to be able to export audio and also store it. So for example, for the vast majority of my clients, I store their recordings for about 2 years in case they want to do a pickup, they want to refresh a campaign or anything else like that. I always store it on a hard drive and also in the cloud, and I always recommend that you back up your work. For what it's worth, I don't think that all voiceover artists are created equal, certainly in the beginning of your career, and I think as you train further, as your recording quality gets better, as your services get better, then your BSF should obviously scale according to that, to some some degree. It's very subjective, though, about how exactly you want to go about that, but that is essentially the point that I want to make. And so, secondly, we come on to the nice, big, murky subject of usage. As an addition to your BSF, you should be charging a usage fee of some kind for any content that is public-facing, i.e. not internally used. And if anyone asks why, then it's because although a client will own the copyright to the script that they send you, they cannot own the copyright to your recorded voice of that script. So you have to be able to offer a license for that recording for a particular period of time. Now, a license fee is negotiable depending on the size of the company in question and how many eyeballs are actually going to be looking at that content. The first type of usage that we really need to talk about is organic online usage. So that is when it's being used on a company's website and maybe some of their socials as well, but only passively. It's not being promoted by any sort of paid campaign in any way. Now, a rate card like Gravy for the Brain suggests that for a period of 1 year, you should be charging a multiple of your BSF for this. And the multiple of your BSF should vary between 50% to 100% for a year. So for example, if you wanted to charge someone 100% BSF for use of your voice for a year on their website and on their passive social media, then that would be your BSF, my BSF of £250, plus another 100% BSF of £250, equaling £500 for a year. However, this is obviously a sliding scale. You don't want to be charging the same to the cat cafe down the road as you do for creating a video for something like Google, as an example. And especially in the corporate world, a lot of these usage fees can be somewhat nominal. I have some clients where I'm charging anywhere as low as 10, 15, 20% for a BSF for 1 year. But it tends to be, in my experience, capped at about 100% BSF for the usage along with the actual BSF for the recording. Now, to add an extra layer of complexity to it, certainly for corporate clients, a lot of the work that you may be doing to put on their website, such as an About Us or a brand film, may last for more than 1 year. It might be 2 or 3, in which case our fees should scale accordingly. Some will request in perpetuity usage because it essentially covers their backs in case they want to use it for the foreseeable future. And you can understand the logic behind that to some degree. Certainly, in perpetuity usage is a definite no-no for any commercial project. But even for businesses, it's wise to try and get some form of time-bound agreement rather than in perpetuity. So if that's 2 years or 3 years, when realistically they probably are going to have to update that video in some way, shape or form if their organization is actually developing and changing. And so many talents, including myself, offer a 1, 2, and 3 year package to cover that form of usage as well. Essentially, this is where you need to do some detective work and work out the size of the company, at what level it's operating on, and where it may be heading. Because you don't want to be granting in perpetuity usage for a little startup thinking it's not going to go anywhere, ultimately just for it to become something like the next Tesla and it still has your voice attached to it, but now there may be conflicts of interest because it's at that higher profile. Oh, and by the way, if you're finding this content useful, then it might also be worth checking out my free courses on Skillshare, which you can watch for a free trial on the platform, one of which focuses on the foundations of voice acting performance, and the other one which focuses on the business of voiceover from a variety of different angles. Both have been watched by over 1,000 students each to unanimous 5-star reviews, and it's a completely free resource to you. So yeah, I recommend checking them out. The next level of usage that I want to talk about is online commercial usage. So a client has decided to market their service or product with actual online social media ad campaigns. Now, the cost of an advertisement will really depend on the number of impressions they buy, the number of eyeballs who are actually going to get onto that content, those adverts. So again, we're talking about having a BSF fee just for the recording and also a separate usage fee. But this time I would price it on a per 3-month period, because these promoted campaigns are definitely going to be time bound in some way, but they're also going to be seeing more eyes on them. So online commercial usage is typically charged at your BSF for every 3-month period of that campaign. So if someone wanted to run a campaign with my voice for 9 months, so that's 3 3-month periods, then it's my BSF of £250 times 3, which is £750, plus my BSF for the recording session as well, also at £250, so £1,000 altogether. But again, this can be negotiable depending on the size of the company. Do some research on the types of questions that you should ask and what criteria you should therefore start to apply. So for example, some voice talents create a scale depending on whether or not something is a micro enterprise between 1 and 9 employees, a small enterprise consisting of between 10 and 49 employees, a medium-sized enterprise of 50 to 249 employees, or a large enterprise of 250 employees or more. Because again, you don't want to be quoting exactly the same to the cat cafe down the road as you do to Coca-Cola, just because they both want to run a Facebook ad campaign. And again, for longer term campaigns, you should also have figures for a 1 year, a 2 year, and a 3 year agreement, because some low level commercial campaigns may well last for that long period of time, or at least they may want the option to run that campaign for that long. And then finally, we have TV commercial or broadcast usage. So again, this is going to scale on the number of eyes that this is going to be going to, and also the geography, whether or not it's going to be regional, for example in London, whether or not it would be nationwide, so in the UK, or whether or not it would be worldwide. Now in the UK, the reach of a television ad is worked out in TVRs, or television ratings. The crucial figure to know is that one TVR equates to around 490,000 people, 500,000 people who will actually be seeing it. And crucially, the end client should know how many TVRs, i.e. how many impressions, they should be buying that advertising space for. Once you have that number of TVRs, or at least an approximate amount, you can then go onto a website called UseFee and enter in both your BSF and the number of TVRs, as well as being able to apply a geographical filter, national versus regional, so that you can actually get an estimate for that. And please note that the number that this comes up with does include a transmission fee, which is your BSF, but that is actually separate from the BSF that you should be charging for your recording. So you take that number and then you add your BSF for the actual recording onto it as well. If this information is not readily available, or the client is being deliberately or unconsciously vague, then it can get a lot more complicated. Rather than making a 45-minute video which incorporates all the different regions of all the different nations in the world, how that might apply, and especially just now in 2022, that kind of content is going to date extremely quickly. So instead, if you find yourself talking about a campaign that could be operating at that level, I really recommend that you refer the project to an agent instead, whose specialism and skill set and knowledge is all about this. And if you're unrepresented, this is a perfectly great time to be able to reach out to a couple of agents, being able to offer them the commission on this project for them to be able to negotiate on your behalf. Almost certainly, the commission that you'll end up paying them will be worth it for the larger, more official, better fee that you'll end up getting. Now that we've established these three different forms of usage very, very broadly, admittedly, the only other thing that I would add is that it's sometimes very useful for online campaigns to think in terms of those impressions. Sometimes for an online commercial campaign, as opposed to a TV commercial campaign, it could still be a massive online campaign featuring in YouTube pre-rolls internationally, in which case they will still have a number of impressions in mind. And quite often what I do when I'm quoting for those bigger online projects is that I'll ask for a ballpark figure in terms of the number of impressions that they're looking for, and then I will put that through the TVR website to give me a rough approximate figure. If that figure is huge, then again, I will refer it to my agent, but if it's not, then at least I've got a number that I can point to. This is how I've found my logic and my working behind it, and that can be a great way of being able to start a conversation on a realistic quote. Now, as I've said before, when talking about showing your working and invoicing, when you make these quotes, always make sure that you lead with a very clear figure, and then underneath that, show your working, so that the client, the end client, doesn't know that you're just making up numbers just to see if you can chance your arm and maybe you'll get lucky. And very, very quickly, I also just want to add a note about how these types of fees may apply to more freelance spaces, for example, on Fiverr and Upwork. So on a platform like Fiverr, it has quite an antiquated criteria where people will talk in terms of commercial rights and broadcast rights. But essentially, with a platform such as Fiverr, you can create your fee structure completely from the ground up. And what some people interpret as commercial rights and what some people interpret as broadcast rights will vary depending on one seller to another. The most important point, as ever, is to understand what the general rationale The logic behind what typical voiceover work outside of these platforms is, so that you can then try and apply it in your own way, whichever way you find most beneficial, to your work on those platforms, if you work in them. Knowing the difference between organic usage, between commercial usage, and between broadcast usage are the three main takeaways, as well as the importance of the BSF and how that works in tandem with all of those things. I hope me going through all of these different variables has added some level of clarity so that you can at least start to formulate your own quoting structures and personalize it so that you can use it for yourself rather than simply just directing people to third-party references, which may be somewhat overwhelming, especially to novices. If you do have any other questions or observations about quoting, then please let me know in the comments below. Please do like, subscribe, and spread the word about this channel as ever. It really does make a difference, and I look forward to seeing you next time.